Dear friends, today is our topic, the last topic of the unit is cathodic protection by impressed current method. In the earlier video, I have given the explanation for cathodic protection by sacrificial anode. This is second type, second method we can say, that is cathodic protection by impressed current method. In this method, impressed current is used to convert the corroding metal from anode to cathode. Basic idea of cathodic method is to force the metal to be corroded to behave like a cathode. That is cathodic protection. So here we use impressed current so as to convert the corroding anodic metal from anode to cathode. Let us take one simple case. Suppose this is an underground pipeline carrying some liquid or water or any other solvent or even the gas. Okay? And this is underground soil, suppose. This is soil surface. Roughly I will show it like this. This is soil surface, isn't it? And underground the soil surface, this pipeline is there carrying some liquid or gas. Okay? Without any type of protective measure, this whatever the electrode potential, as per that it will show oxidation reaction, electrons will be lost, it will be taken by the any cathode material nearby the pipeline or maybe by the medium. So this will work as anode, this will undergo deterioration, oxidation process. So this anode can be made cathode by using impressed current. Now what is this impressed current? How to derive this impressed current? From where we take the impressed current? Impressed current mainly taken from the current source, from the direct current source from battery or rectifier. For that purpose, one insoluble anode is chosen, like graphite, like silica ion, like platinum. Suppose we'll take an anode like this. This is an insoluble anode that is nearby the structure. And to this insoluble anode, isn't it? This I will write. This is insoluble anode. Okay? Maybe platinum or silica ion or graphite, that kind of material. Sufficient direct current is applied to the insoluble anode from the battery or rectifier. Okay? And this is kept in a nearby the structure we want to protect, and it is kept in a backfill made of coke bricks or gypsum to have sufficient contact with the conducting medium. And this is then connected to the current source. So this is positive, this will be negative, and like this. So negative terminal is going to this structure to be protected. This we can say current source. This is the impressed current source, or we will write this is impressed current source, isn't it? And positive terminal of this source is connected to the structure which we have made anode. To that we have given sufficient direct current and placed near the structure to be protected. So negative terminal will be connected to the structure to be protected. From thereby this earlier anode, now it is made cathode. This is called as the impressed current. To nullify the corrosion current, to counterbalance the corrosion current, impressed current is applied. Impressed current is applied in the opposite direction, isn't it? Once again I repeat, for this purpose, to convert this anode to cathode, sufficient direct current is applied to the insoluble anode, maybe platinum or silica ion or graphite, okay, and is connected to the positive terminal, and negative is going to the cathode. So earlier this metal structure was losing the electron, now it is counterbalanced, it is gaining the electron. So this will be positive anode, this become negative. This way, by giving impressed current from the impressed current source, like a battery or rectifier to this material, this structure, we can convert from anode to cathode when we connect the pipe to this material. So underground pipelines, containers, cables, isn't it? And open box coolers or even the transmission towers can be protected by this kind of method called as impressed current method. Bit costly and some drawbacks are there, but this is one efficient method when we practically it is impossible to convert minimize the effect of medium. We use this kind of method. Two methods, simple methods we have seen for cathodic protection, isn't it? Now next method is called as second method is anodic protection. Anodic protection. Now the name itself indicate what is meaning of anodic protection. In anodic protection, from the name itself we can line meaning of this. In this method, we force the metal to behave more and more anodic by applying anodic current in the direction that makes it more anodic. What will happen if the metal is working as a more anodic? Suppose this is aluminium, okay? The structure we want to protect, it will form Al3++, 3 electron. This is oxidation reaction. We are increasing the rate of this reaction by applying anodic current in the direction that makes the metal more anodic. Will be increasing the rate of reaction. So it will be forming more number of the ions by losing more number of electrons. What will happen by this way? These electrons will be taken by the medium, suppose oxygen, right? It will form oxygen ions, these oppositely charged ions, positive and negative ions, isn't it? So it will be twice and thrice. It will form Al2O3 as a rust product on the exposed part of metal, and that coating is found to be stable. So this kind of method is forcing the metal to form the corresponding oxide layer or corresponding coating on the exposed part. That coating is found to be very stable, that is protective, that is of self-healing nature, very thin layer, thereby underlying part of the metal can be protected. So this method is basically applied to the element who shows active passive behavior. Who shows active passive behavior? Like aluminium, like titanium, like chromium, like stainless steel, like nickel. These are the elements who shows active passive behavior. Under the particular range of potential, they remain passive. They show active passive behavior. We know meaning of active passive behavior. Once again I repeat, what is meaning of active passive behavior? When they are exposed to the medium, when this is suppose chromium, when they exposed to the medium, this is corrosive medium, they will undergo this reaction. Okay? And on the exposed part of the metal, they will form a uniform layer. Uniform coating will be formed on the exposed part in a shortest time. Once it forms the coating, this coating is found to be very stable, very thin coating, very fine coating, protective, and it is of self-healing nature. When the coating gets broken down, it repairs itself. Thereby, the underlying part of the metal gets protection for a very long period. So the metal who shows active passive behavior, who has a tendency to undergo oxidation reaction, by using a electronic device that is called potentiostat, we force this metal to fastly undergo oxidation reaction, forms a coating on the exposed part as early as, thereby the underlying part gets protected. Thereby the metal structure or the metal rod or the metal unit can be protected for a longer period, isn't it? Because the coating is found to be very, very stable and protective, isn't it? Let us take one example. Let us consider this. Suppose this is a container containing some liquid or water or any other solvent. This is a container we want to protect. Show one example like this. Okay, this tank we want to protect. This tank containing water, suppose we want to protect this, isn't it? So we'll write tank to be protected. This tank to be protected. Okay, This tank we have made anode part of the cell. We are applying anodic current in the direction that makes it more anodic. For that purpose this tank has which is made anode. To make it more anodic, we are using an electronic device that is called as potentiostat. So this one connection of the potentiostat is given to the tank to be protected. Okay, there will be one reference electrode like this. That potentiostat maintains constant potential. Potentiostat maintains constant potential between the tank to be protected and the reference electrode, isn't it? This is undergoing oscillation reaction, right? This will be showing, forcing it to undergo oscillation reaction. Not like this, we are forcing it to undergo oscillation reaction, and we'll put a voltmeter indicating this is maintaining constant potential between this and this. So this is my reference electrode. One connection is given to reference electrode, and there is one auxiliary cathode. One connection is given to. So we'll put an emitter here, and it will be showing like this. This is this, and this is our auxiliary cathode. This is cathode. It will show reduction reaction. Okay. So, and this is a container containing some electrolyte, okay, or some solvent or some salt, or we can simply say water. This is that method in which is mainly applied to element who show the active passive behavior, where if this is a stainless steel tank or aluminium tank, we have made it anode, we are supplying anodic current, it will be fastly undergoing anodic reaction, isn't it? It forming ions and electrons. Electrons will be taken by the medium, and it forms a coating on the exposed part. On the exposed part of metal, hurriedly, in a fast manner, this will be forced to form a coating of metal oxides or hydroxide, and this coating will make the structure passive. Underlying part will get protection for longer period. This is a method called as anodic protection method, wherein the structure we want to protect, we made it anode part of the cell. This is the one short note in the protection part. So two short notes coming under heading cathodic protection, and one short note coming under heading anodic protection. Now last two points of the units, isn't it? First short note left is galvanic corrosion. One is called galvanic corrosion, isn't it? We know galvanic cell, isn't it? One part of the cell will work as anode part, one part will work as cathode part. But this galvanic type of corrosion is not necessarily is a wet corrosion. It may be dry corrosion, or it may be wet corrosion, isn't it? So that is the case of galvanic corrosion, wherein two different metals comes in a contact with each other in presence of the given medium, maybe dry oxygen, or maybe wet condition, neutral electrolyte medium. One part will work as anode, one part will work as cathode. More the difference in the value of electrode potential of the two parts, yeah, two metals, more is the rate of corrosion. For example, these are the brass fittings, suppose these are the brass taps, okay, and it is then fitted with GI pipe, which is having connection with GI pipe, suppose. Maybe like this, and connected to this in this fashion. The fittings are there in our washrooms. Maybe like this. This is a brass container, brass taps, and this is GI pipe. This is one situation, and this is carrying water. Okay, so galvanic corrosion. Two different metals are there like this, brass and this pipe. Maybe dry or wet. Here it is a water, so the wet condition. So this will work as anode part of the cell, this will work as cathode part, and there is a dissolution of this. There is a continuous decay and destruction of this. So that simple type of reaction, we can write two different metals in contact with a dry or wet condition. If not even two different metal, two different parts of same metal also shows this kind of reaction. For example, this is a pipeline. This is a structure, isn't it? This is the internal structure of the pipeline, intact, no corrosion. But when you go for bending of the pipe, when bending it like this or coupling it, then this much internal structure remains as it is, this much part also remains as it is, and somewhere here internal structure get collapse, internal structure get disturbed, okay, or it is under stress, under strain. So that particular part will work as anode, this part will work as cathode, and it is exposed to so and so medium. This is also case of galvanic corrosion. Suppose this is medium is H2O plus oxygen, and this is iron pipe. So two different metals or two different parts of same metal, this kind of corrosion can be shown. Now what are the reactions of this type? Same reactions what we have seen in a weight corrosion by oxygen absorption, or if this is a hydrogen medium, weight corrosion by evolution of hydrogen. This is the example of galvanic corrosion. So if a short note is there, so many such cases we can sort out and we can write the mechanism, either dry or weight, again weight of two types, isn't it? So this is a one simple short note that is called as galvanic corrosion, weight or dry. And last point in the syllabus is, the last short note is, what is that? Last is concentration cell corrosion. Second is concentration cell corrosion, isn't it? What is that? This is also called as differential aeration corrosion. This is also called as differential aeration corrosion, isn't it? These are the part and parcel of, I think, galvanic corrosion. Concentration cell corrosion or differential aeration corrosion, the cell is formed, corrosion cell is formed due to the difference in the concentration of air. Corrosion cell is formed due to the difference in the concentration of oxygen. That may be called as concentration cell corrosion or differential aeration corrosion. Let us take a simplest case. This is a tank. This is a tank containing water. In this we have kept water like this or some solvent, right? And this is a medium. Suppose this is medium is oxygen. Okay, so on this metal, who has got some negative value of standard electrode potential, attack by this oxygen on this part as well as on this part is easier. So we can say on this part there is a high concentration of oxygen. At the same time, attack of same oxygen on this part or on the underlying part below the water level is less. So we can say this is low concentration of oxygen. So one container, same metal, one part is having higher concentration above the water level, higher concentration because attack of oxygen is easier. Below the liquid level on this metal structure, attack of oxygen is less. So, or we can say difficult. So it is a low concentration of oxygen. So as per the oxygen is concerned, oxygen concentration is concerned, the part of metal on which there is a low concentration of oxygen, that will work as anode part of the cell. Higher concentration will work as cathode part of the cell, and they will undergo rusting. That is called differential. So because of difference in the concentration of air or oxygen, anode cathode formation occurs. Or one more simple case that we have already explained, this iron bar or magnesium bar, this is oxygen. On this part, there is accumulation of dirt particle or sand particle or any type of accumulation of impurity. In that case, attack of this oxygen on this underlying part as well as on this underlying part, enveloped by some impurity, enveloped by some sand particles, and so is difficult. Attack of oxygen is difficult here, isn't it? So this is anodic, less oxygen concentration. Attack on this part is more, so this is cathode. Again, due to the difference in the concentration of oxygen, there is a formation of anode and cathode. So that is called differential aeration corrosion. Now we can write anode reaction, we can write anode reaction, cathode reaction, like Fe anode will form Fe2++. 2 electron will be going from anode to cathode. So 2 electrons taken by
medium have O2, it will form O2 minus. These oppositely charged species, they will diffuse towards each other and will form ferrous oxide, isn't it? Or it on further oxidation, it may form some other product, Fe2O3, etc., as a rust product on the exposed part of the metal in between anode and cathode. This is a case called as differential aeration corrosion. Here we will complete the unit number 6. Okay, thank you.